Encased is an isometric sci-fi RPG which takes place on an alternate past version of Earth back in the 70s, and inside of a mysterious dome. The dome is a gigantic force field, and inside there's different terrain and all kinds of strange animals and anomalies and goings-on. Why it exists and who made it is a mystery, but if you go back into the dev stuff, it was originally supposed to be aliens. What isn't a mystery, though, is that the technological marvels it holds are valuable. No one quite understands how the dome's tech treasures work, yet the various artifacts have different, rather interesting abilities, and they generally work just fine without a user manual.
Side effects may include radioactivity, apathy, halo eye, insanity, neural penetration, or death. By purchasing, you release Cronus and its subsidiaries worldwide from all liability and perpetuity from any and all detrimental effects beyond control and the control of mankind. Use your own risk. No guarantee of non-exploding is provided.
Many people will pay top dollar for these treasures, and the Cronus Corporation, which is backed by powerful governments around the world, is more than happy to generously take their money. That said, it's not easy to get these artifacts out of the dome. Once people go in, then they can never leave again. It's a one-way trip. The force field will let human beings inside of the dome, but not out. This means that any employees who sign up are trapped inside. If they want to, they can quit, but they still wouldn't be able to go home again even if they did. If they want to live a comfortable life, or at least comfortable-ish, then they just do their jobs and help hoist out the potentially marvelous and/or deadly puzzling pieces of tech. Meanwhile, when it comes to humanity at large outside of the dome, international tensions are high. If contact is lost with the dome, then the world will likely blow up. Controlling the dome home is of the utmost concern. As the saying goes, you can have it over my dead body. That's been accepted as a challenge at this point. And this is where you come in, literally. You are an employee of the Cronus Corporation and you're going down into that dome. Character customization. There are pre-made characters to choose from, but the story here is only flavor text. They're simply pre-mades for those who don't want to make a custom character. If you do want to customize your own character, then you choose your character's name, age, sex, avatar look, portrait, stats, skills, traits, and their job, or wing, at the company. Wings are essentially like corporate factions. Picking one influences certain skills and opens up unique dialogue options during the game. You'll get along best with the faction that you choose, and some factions are a little bit antagonistic to each other, primarily the blacks and oranges. They're color-coded. Blacks are security, oranges are essentially criminals who are being given a sort of second chance in the dome to be janitors or oftentimes cannon fodder. Attributes. Your stats in this game are labeled attributes, and they're the usual set for the most part. I'm gonna use D&D references here because most RPGs do take that basic stat block as inspiration from their core stat set, and yet flavor text muddles this across video games when they're almost always the same. So for ease of reference, strength is muscle, wisdom is perception, constitution is guts, charisma was so cool it didn't even need to get changed, intelligence is brains, dexterity is deafness. An important note though, this is one of those RPGs where if you have an int of 1 or 2, then you will experience the game in a unique way. If you go that route, then you will be able to unlock some unique skills on the skill trees. You also get a free trait, which is called As a Bag of Hammers. You don't get the skills on the skill tree that require this unless you have that low int. Next up, there are two additions on top of those usual stats, Fortune and Psyche. Fortune helps things go your way. It is as it sounds. It just raises your probability of good things happening to you. It works well enough. All the same though, I found fortune to be useless to invest in because you don't really need to get lucky to succeed in the game. Plus, lucky cookies, which boost your luck if you eat them, do decently well. I mean, it happened enough that I had lucky events that I noticed. I think a player would be better off just ignoring this stat and spending their points elsewhere. Psyche I did find to be useful though. Mainly this was because I was making a psychic character. It sounded fun at the time. However, when I see that psychic powers are in a game, then I also know that having a psychic defense is probably a good idea since psychic powers can be OP sometimes. I also often play face type characters in RPGs just so I can explore dialogue fully with my PC. When I do this, then I just let my companions cover my PC's combat weaknesses. I get both the combat experience from my companions and the role-playing experience from my main. The idea of combining this face style of play from my main with psychic combat that enhanced her influence, that seemed like a great fit. Maybe too good even. After all, I'd have a well-rounded, charismatic lead with the ability to blow up brains if she can't convince them. Not exactly a tank, of course, but not exactly squishy-squishy. I like this option. However, it turned out not to be balanced with how I played my character. I think you could still have fun in this game with other builds, but the psychic route for me was pretty dang overpowered on hard mode, which I'll get into later. For now, on to where a psychic belongs, and the other wings. The wings are simple and color-coded. Psychics are silvers, mechanics are blues, medics are whites, security guards are blacks, oranges do the grunt work. And the two little caveats there are that the silvers, the psychics, tend to be administrative. So basically, your managers all have telekinetic power and other things, which is a little bit dystopian. And then the people doing the grunt work have criminal backgrounds, hence the orange color, kind of the orange prison jumpsuit sort of look. The idea is that the oranges are getting a second chance by going to live in the dome, but it's not a great chance. Anyway, which skills are chosen should generally fit with the chosen job. For example, a silver unlocks silver-only dialogue options, and then can pass related checks on influence with related skills. So it's usual for an RPG in that you don't have to focus on your job. You can do whatever you like skill-wise and not specialize. But as always, specialization is usually better, because then your skills fit your job. What your skills do is straightforward. You also often get experience points for using them. When you level up, then you can put your skill points into either combat or applied skills. You have to split it between the two, you don't get separate pools for both. The weapon types are self-explanatory. Contraptions is pretty useless, in my opinion, unless you really want to make extra junk that you don't quite need, or want to be able to disable traps that you find, which you could also probably just set off anyway and get minimal XP for disarming. I raised that up really high because I wasn't sure if it would come in handy, but it didn't. Piloting is mainly useful for operating vehicles on the world map, which is useful as it lets you get around faster, but I wasn't sure when I first saw it if maybe there'd be helicopters or other things that I could operate, and there weren't. So this is a useful skill, but it definitely doesn't have a ton of applications. It would also let you use servo shells so you could have a robotic suit, but I never really messed with those, never needed to. I tried them out a little bit, but meh. Definitely a playstyle you could go with if you wanted to though. Medicine is useless, I think. Food heals you, healing stations heal you for a low price, and there are healing items too. So I almost never needed this skill. It rarely even popped up in dialogue options. I think to get much out of it, you'd need to be part of the White Wing career path. Otherwise, I don't imagine it would be worthwhile. Tech is useful though, and its description even flat out tells you this. You will need it high enough to be able to upgrade your weapon through crafting if you want to upgrade your weapon. Otherwise, you would have to just hope something good showed up in the shops. So realistically, you're gonna want to probably focus on one or two types of weapons. Science was also an okay one to take. It opened up some dialogue options for me. You can use it constantly to do things such as hacking computers for info and control panels to open doors. If you get this skill high enough and find the right terminals in game, then you can even hack them to respec your character for free. Otherwise, you'd have to pay a fee to do it. So, not bad. Definitely a skill that had multiple uses during the game. Criminal, however, was ridiculously useful. This is because money is hard to get in the game in any large quantity, and this lets you bypass that by pickpocketing NPCs. The higher your skill, the more value you can pickpocket. I never ran out of money due to this. Heck, I even got an achievement. A rare one. But hey, I mean, gotta make a living, right? Anyway, the criminal skill opens doors for exploration, and I was also able to acquire a large volume of items from locked containers. Some of these containers were owned, and NPCs would go aggro if they caught you stealing, but generally containers were unowned and just locked. Some quest items were also in containers, and stealing them in the second act let me bypass annoying, time-consuming fetch quests that I didn't feel like doing to progress the main plot. I was also able to solve some side quests in this way. It was really useful. On top of all of that, when you do a criminal skill, such as lockpicking, then you get XP. The only downside that I saw was that Sparrow, one of your possible companions, has his relationship value go down if you steal. He hates stealing. Do it too much around him? I don't know if he'd actually attack you or if he'd leave the party, but it's very clear it's not good if you want to use him. There are other companions you can have, so it's not necessary to keep Sparrow around. Influence is basically just double charisma. If you want to choose charismatic options, then making influence high will open up more. Survival is highly useful in many ways. After 30 skill points are spent, then a player can scope out random interactions on the world map to see if they're even worth engaging in. A player will also be able to cook. The cooking skill is useful, but cooking can wind up granting many experience points later on if the chef perk is also taken. At 60 points, the player also gains more carrying capacity and receives 3 times more experience for discovering a location, and that discovery XP is only given when a location is first found, so it makes sense to take this particular skill early on. Other skills listed under survival were okay too, but personally, I thought that these 4 were the best ones. Looks. You can change various traits on your avatar, but the details are only your own preference. Nothing here matters. Looks are only somewhat varied, but there are enough options to choose from under hair, head, etc. that it's fine. Your character's portrait is fully customizable. The game even tells you exactly which folder to place a custom portrait into, which is nice and handy, no guesswork there. But I just went ahead with double buns here because I thought her hairstyle was cute and made an avatar which matched. I changed it later when I was playing around with the respec options, so you'll see that in the video. Traits. Pick one, and it'll give you pros and cons. Very straightforward, it's just an extra little customization. During the course of the game, when you level up, you'll also be able to get perks, and these will work in much the same way as the trait. By the way, if you choose the perk called Mysterious Patronage, then you'll obtain perks at a faster rate when you level up. So if you're interested in that and you're gonna play this game, something to keep in mind so you can get the most perks. You don't wanna take that too late. Lastly, when it comes to leveling up in general, then your character's learnability score can make this process faster. If your learnability is at 100, you get all of the experience points that you earned. If it's more, then you get more than 100%. You get more than you earned. By the end of the game, I had learnability rather high. This meant that for most of the game, I was way over-leveled. I didn't even need to farm mobs, and I think this was a part of why. The only reason I even bothered to pickpocket was sometimes they had stuff I wanted and I couldn't afford it, and it was too high in value to steal, so I was stockpiling. The gameplay. When you start a game, you can pick from 4 different difficulties: easy, medium, hard, and sane. And based on their descriptions, I chose hard. The next thing to know is that there are 3 acts in Encased. You find out problems in Act 1, solve them in Act 2, and then wrap everything up in Act 3. Finding the problems in Act 1 is fine. I was interested in exploring the setting, learning about its lore, interacting with NPCs, hunting for treasures in containers, doing quests, testing the boundaries of what was possible in the game, and figuring out where to go and what to do. That was fun. All in all, I played the game for a total of about 55 hours, but I'd say that around 20 hours, I began to get bored for 2 reasons. One is that the battles were hella easy. I stomped everything, and that wasn't fun. I didn't want to limit myself to try to artificially make a challenge either. It just feels cheap when I do that in video games. I feel like I shouldn't have to make a game fun, and if I'm stretching myself to try to, then I might as well play something else. How I accidentally Hulk smashed the difficulty was simple though. I had a psychic main and stuck to that. I also did a lot of damage due to crafting weapons to become higher and higher levels. Meanwhile, my party was also leveled up too much because I'd maxed out learnability as much as I could. Crafting weapons gave me additional XP, and I had my PC focus on skills in general, and using those also gave her XP. On top of all of that, I also noticed 2 particular things that boosted XP and went for them. Getting tons of extra XP from new zones was a survival skill, and getting plus 50 XP from cooking anything was a ridiculously beneficial perk since food was everywhere and so were bonfires to cook. In the cities, there were also stoves, so no matter where you were, you usually could get some cheap food and cook, so that was a pretty good one to take. Seriously, cooking is weirdly op in this game. You can even click craft maximum to just gorge your XP bar in one go. Since thieving is also broken, and doing that let me get lots of money and items, a rogue chef might very well be perfection. The next issue is simply that the game stretches itself way too thin. Containers are incredibly numerous in almost every zone, which is exciting at first, yet these containers often have nothing in them, and frequently things you won't need. Getting a little XP and an occasional lucky draw adds incentive to explore these things, but after the umpteenth time exploring a flower pot, it begins to feel very dull. The exploration mechanic went for quantity over quality, for sure. This was also frustrating sometimes. For example, avoiding flower pots was an easy enough choice. Weigh your likelihood of getting a good reward versus actual dirt or nothing, and probably it's not going to pay out enough to check every single flower pot when there are so many. Yet, Some things looked intriguing to explore, such as the skeleton high up in an abandoned tower at a psychically irradiated former base. You couldn't even get up into the tower without a specific item, and it was surrounded by enemies. You either have to sneak by these enemies or fight them. When I went through several steps of effort to get to a container like this skeleton, then I expected a good reward, yet I often still got junk. This lack of reward also lowered the thrill of exploration for me, because jumping through hoops in dangerous places wound up being little more important than digging through random trash by the side of the road. I would sometimes find good things in very easy places, and that just seemed to undermine trying to go to areas and put in a lot of effort. NPCs became irrelevant in a similar way. They were frequently voiced, at times they'd even converse with each other aloud, and that autonomy can help make a world feel more vibrant. However, since the maps were large and mostly empty, useless space with useless containers, their presence seemed kind of forced in context. They just kind of meandered around and didn't do anything and didn't have much of a personality beyond a line or two. That just made them feel like set dressing. They didn't seem like they were living a believable existence, which defeated the point of using them. Some had okay things to say, but trying to speak with them quickly felt boring and like a waste of time. And when it comes to NPCs that blatantly give quests, it was the same sort of thing, and their quests are often just dumb. Some NPCs are okay, such as Melville in Roadside Picnic and Audrey in Roadside Picnic, but even then, they're not really fleshed out. And they also give dumb quests, such as Melville wanting battle chess. Plus, how bad quests could be became horribly apparent in Act 2. Solving problems in Act 2 is tedious. Side quests are inane. I already mentioned that Melville wants to play battle chess. To get him battle chess, you have to go all the way to another zone in a car, talk to a guy inside of a house, pay 200 kronbons, get back in your car, drive back to the zone, talk to him, give him the program, and then that's pretty much it. You don't really even get anything from it except for him briefly commenting. It just felt like a lame side quest. Similarly, this girl wants a watch, you give her a watch. That's it. That's how the quests work. Typical fetch quests, but usually kind of forced, and also, it's not clear where anyone is. For example, in the watch instance, I ran into her on accident, and I wondered how would people normally find her, and I Googled it, and people were wondering where you found her, and a lot of them did not know, to the point that when one person asked, somebody else commented, "When you find out, let me know." It's not well managed. To be fair, side quests are avoidable. However, I often find side quests to be mixed bags in games. I'll like some and dislike others. Yeah, I didn't like any of the side quests in this game. They just felt like busy work at worst and typical at best, such as being told to go slay some mutant cockroaches. I've done pest control before, it's not a big deal. But it's not good or bad, it's just okay, done. That's mediocre to me. As for companion quests, those are inconsistent. For example, you can see two listed here. However, the companion my character knew best was called Crump. And Crump didn't even have a side quest pop up on the companion quest list. Yet, as I got to know him better over time, he kept speaking about his past and clearly wanted to meet up with somebody someday who was in the dome. I tried looking in the dialogue file to see if Crump and the person can meet up, and it looks like they can't. Now, I could be wrong here, because sometimes, as mentioned in the watch quest, there's not a lot of info. However, it looks like Crump's personal questline was just never finished by the devs and ends on an open-ended sort of note. I tried hunting around online to see if I was wrong, but at best, I just found similarly confused players. Overall, though, I didn't care for the companions much and didn't even bother to make sure I found them all. Some of them are outright annoying, such as a little Japanese robot girl with a gigantic gun who calls both you and her father senpai, which was odd.
Something clicks in the head of a motionless Yoko. The white plastic of her eyes shines with faint light. You see her dark brown iris and bright pupils standing out. They're almost indistinguishable from the real ones.
Social mode. Hello, senpai.
A quiet click sounds in the robot's head.
The Magellan base is a place where I was built and modified. Senpai's laboratory is also equipped with all the infrastructure I need. Therefore, I belong in Magellan.
She suddenly stops talking and seems to freeze. Then she looks at the blue light, looking like a faint shimmer of a nightlight. She looks at Akira.
Sometimes I contradict my senpai's will. I suppose it has to do with...
It was not enjoyable to me. I did not like the voice acting on the robot girl. It felt very cringy, and not in a funny kind of way. Add that on to the lack of side quest clarity, which made trying to delve into their stories feel unrewarding and like a possible waste of time, and I had less interest in getting to know all of the companions. So I didn't really bother. Fox and Crump were okay to me. I liked them well enough, and so I just kept adventuring with those two. But the biggest issue in Act 2 for me was, unfortunately, the main plot itself. Essentially, it's a fetch quest fest. Everybody wants to rule the world, or at least their own little world inside this dome. There are different factions that want different methods of control. To that end, you're sent around on tedious fetch quests in a bureaucratic shuffle. You're told to go here and talk to this NPC, and then go there and talk to that NPC, and now go and talk to another NPC on a different part of the world map and get this item, get that item, and on for each faction. And there are six. Just wasn't fun. These bureaucratic themed quests also often felt contrived. For instance here, I was supposed to interview two candidates for a job. However, I'd already turned one in for a crime. I was on bad terms with her, yet I still had to go to that zone and speak to them both before I could say to another NPC on a different level of the building that I didn't want to hire the bad choice. I kept trying to go along with the plot and just finish the game, but after a bit I said fuck it, thug life, and stole the quest items I needed. Then I just rushed ahead to Act 3. In Act 3, everything wraps up, and I won't spoil the game for anybody. It's pretty much a straight shot to the ending, and you don't even have to fight anybody if you utilize sneaking, skills, and or items. As for this part of the story, and again, to keep it spoiler free, I'll just say that some factions tell you what they want to happen with a final choice. You also have a few options of your own, which you can choose to do or not. After looking up the endings, I found out that there are 14 of them, but only one is actually good. The others are just about who gets screwed how hard. There really isn't a lot of depth to that. There's no gray area. It's just straightforward and plain. Otherwise, there were also some other minor problems during play, such as my companions not understanding how to avoid anomalies.
Jesus, it burns. Oh dear, it hurts so much.
Unless I treated them like I was babysitting, then they often did this. That was annoying. The story slash characters. This is one of the main issues that I have with Encased. The setting is decently intricate. You can see posters of various types, play a few mini games, hear dozens of voiced characters, see good quality art slides for cutscenes, little details such as characters in different cities being related to each other, and more. It's clear that a lot of passion and thought went into the first act of this world and into some of the NPCs. However, over time, this level of quality just gets stretched too thin. Add on the poor fetch quest feeling in Act 2, and that cheapens all of the hard work that went into building Act 1. In this way, the game flounders in generating a real sense of its identity. It just doesn't feel solid. Nothing in the setting winds up feeling either touching or noteworthy to a meaningful degree. I found this to be disappointing because at points I did see hints of promise in the game, such as a cool moment between the companion Fox and my PC, which I won't spoil because it's a major point, and how an NPC wouldn't speak to my character again after she killed his buddy in the city's illegal fighting pit. Yet, such intriguing spots are like tiny bits of glitter on otherwise gray ground, hints of past ideas which show how nice the game could have been if everything had been fully set up as originally intended. The overall impression that I got was basically that the game had a huge amount of passion behind it and many grand plans, but as development continued, then either time or money became a problem. It's as if instead of hacking away and tightening down the content to match a newer, smaller scope, too much extraneous stuff was still left in from a final draft. Then that past stuff drowned out the good, and the good was never fully finished anyway. I could be wrong here, but that was the impression which I got while playing. The graphics. There are little posters, art panels during cutscenes, and lots of other things that all come together nicely. However, nothing in the game's art stood out as particularly amazing to me. Yes, the details were nice, but the huge map layouts and frequently useless containers unfortunately counterbalanced these good points with monotony. Meanwhile, no monster designs, pieces of art, or anything else were particularly memorable. It was a well-made game, don't get me wrong, but it was definitely standard for its niche of being a modern isometric RPG. It reminded me of other indie games that I played in its style, like Atom RPG. Very much. But that also means that if I can look at a game and I'm just like, oh, it's like this one or that one, I think that's pretty typical. The sound. It works fine, but again, nothing memorable here. Nothing stood out to me. There was no music I paused to listen to or sounds that hit at just the right moment in the right way. One category that is memorable though, the Easter eggs. There are many Easter eggs in this game, and I know I would miss some even if I tried to make a comprehensive list. Here are some which I noticed in Encased. It's heavily influenced by the novel Roadside Picnic. It's what the neutral faction is called, and you can see the name above the diner. Additionally, there are six factions that rule their own territories, called the Picnic, the New Committee, the Church, Phalanx, Carmen Heights, and the Fops. In the novel Roadside Picnic, the world is divided up into six zones. Similarly, Cronus employees act like how stalkers are described in the book. They trespass into a zone to take away valuable alien artifacts, all to get their paychecks, and then their employer sells these mysterious artifacts for a profit. Another game which was heavily influenced by Roadside Picnic, though not a direct adaptation either, was Stalker. In that game, you throw bolts to detect anomalies, and in Encased, you also throw bolts, although to discharge anomalies. In the skill trees, you can spot memes being used as icons. There are also more subtle details, such as a computer being called Minerva, which is likely a reference to the sci-fi author Robert A. Heinlein's sentient computer called Minerva. And there are also many puns, such as with Melville's leg. Their puns give the quality a leg up because I happen to like puns. Final thoughts. If you're like me and favoring isometric RPGs and like to take your time exploring, then I think Encased can be entertaining for a long while. However, I think eventually tedium does take over, which winds up being disappointing in context. The level of detail in the first act underlined to me that the devs cared. Then I tried to see if I could find a list of Easter eggs for when I would make the video, and in doing so, I found out more about the devs' original vision. It was highly ambitious. This makes me a little sad, because I think in the end it was that very ambition which kinda self-sabotaged them and thus the game. I feel like Encased is likely a decent story about how a studio can be really passionate, have a successful Kickstarter, still be restricted in scope due to real-world obstacles, whatever they may be, and then be unwilling to make compromises on the content. To me, it seems like they preferred to overreach rather than cut back on the things that they wanted. Yet, if this game had been shorter and polished more, with loose ends tightened up, then I think I would have liked it better. I would have felt like it was more cohesive and had more of a sense of identity, more of a world to explore, as opposed to a wide expanse of mostly uninteresting quests and empty containers. For example, if companion NPCs all had strong character development and side quests, then I think I could have felt more invested in the world of Encased. After all, if I felt like my choices could affect them, then I think the risks and rewards that I faced would have carried some actual weight for me. In comparison, the lack of depth that they did have was just kinda dull. Meanwhile, most NPCs were non-entities to me. Having a bunch of random NPCs wandering around, which say little to nothing that's relevant, just meant that I usually ignored them. They felt like a waste of time, so I didn't bother talking to them or stopping to listen to them. To be fair, sure, in real life tons of people go about their lives and are boring. As a result, they're basically background to a person's daily life in a city. But in a game, I'm coming in to be entertained and drawn into the setting. People as background noise does add to a game superficially, since it mimics real life, but that's not the heart of a game. So Encased focusing on the superficial and the way, instead of focusing on trying to have a core heart, made things feel a tad messy. To me, it felt almost as if decorative paint was slapped onto something before it was fully done. And sadly, that was the trend here. Quantity over quality. The unique details that I liked in Act 1 just became less and less. The poor second act really hammered that home, too. Details that I liked just became more and more minimized by the amount of content that I didn't. Those fetch quests were awful. I read a little bit about about what the intent was, and it looked like the devs had been hoping to convey a sense of how annoying bureaucracy is, but it just dragged on too long. If I hadn't been able to steal the necessary quest items for the main plotline, then I don't know if I'd have even bothered finishing the game. The ending in the third act wasn't amazing enough to make up for all of that in Act 2 either. It was okay, it wasn't a bad ending that I got, but it just didn't make up for it, you know? On a final note, this game ain't for kiddies. There are some disturbing elements in it, such as a very blatant suicide. And at the end of the game, there is a slide about a woman undergoing extreme sexual abuse, syphilis is mentioned, and she's shown half naked and restrained. I stayed away from the faction that she was in during the game because I was bored and didn't want to bother with that faction at all if I didn't have to. So suddenly seeing this slide in the epilogue about an NPC I never met was gross and strange. There are other points in the game that are more meant for adults as well. Can't recommend this one to kids.